used by God to defeat the Canaanites, and she told him to take his army to attack the Canaanites. But we see in this passage, Barak's response is to say, if you, Deborah, come with me to the battle, then I'll go. Otherwise, I won't go. And it's unclear what his motivation was. It's possible that he was scared to go by himself because Deborah was a prophetess of God, so maybe he didn't think he was spiritual enough to lead the people. It's possible that he didn't want to take responsibility by himself. Maybe he was afraid that the people of Israel wouldn't respect his authority. But for whatever reason, Barak didn't do what Deborah commanded him from God. Instead, he said, I'll only do it if Deborah, you go with me. And we see that Deborah's response to this, and she's speaking on the behalf of God, is to say that because of this, God will not allow you to defeat Sisera himself, but instead, he will use a woman who was jailed when we read later on. So we see in here that there's a precedence for when a man doesn't take responsibility for his duties, that God is willing to use a woman instead. And that's true today as well. If we are, in a lot of ways, I find in the generation that we live that men aren't willing to take responsibility where they should. One place is the home. If in our homes, men a lot of times just they make the woman take on their responsibility because they're not willing to step up to the plate and do their responsibility. And we see that God himself is no respecter of persons. If men don't do what they're supposed to do, God can easily use a woman. He can use a child. And so it's important for us to realize this and do the will of God. And we see this in our society today as well, from a secular point of view. What this chart is up here is it's giving the percent of 25 to 32-year-olds with at least a four-year college degree. And it's going from 1970 to 2013. And we see that in 1970, 12% of women had a college degree in this age group, and 20% of men. But we see that as time progressed, over time, women have surpassed men in the percentage that have a college degree. So in 2013, 38% of women have it, and 31% of men. So why do y'all think that this is happening? One reason, one potential reason, a hypothesis that I have, is that it may come down to entitlement. So sometimes men think they're men, so they're going to be successful because they're men. But when it comes down to it, you're only successful if you're willing to work hard. And when you have entitlement, then you don't work hard. And so what happens a lot of times, in a society where men are put higher than women, you find the women are working harder than the men. And we have to be careful that this doesn't happen. And this same type of entitlement can occur in Christianity. It occurs with Christians. On Wednesday night prayers, we've been going through the book of Hebrews. And part of the reason we're doing that is because we want the scriptures to speak to us instead of, a lot of times we come up with a message and then we try to find scriptures to support it. Instead, we want to start with the scriptures, and that's why we're going through the book of Hebrews, and we're learning a lot of things. One thing that we talked about was this particular set of verses, Hebrews chapter 10, verses 26 through 27. It says, if we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. What this is saying is that if you're a Christian and you deliberately keep on sinning, you will get the same judgment as non-Christians, as the enemies of God. And a lot of times as Christians, we become entitled. We think we deserve heaven just because of our title. But the truth is, if we as a Christian continue to live in sin, then that's a reflection of whether we truly have faith. Someone who continues to deliberately do sin that's evidence that they don't really believe in God. And so we as Christians should be careful that we don't become entitled to think that we're automatically going to go to heaven when we continue to reject Jesus Christ. Moving on, Luke 19 verse 40 says, "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." So this is another example where if human beings think that they're entitled, human beings as a whole, Jesus even says that if humans don't praise God, the stones themselves will cry out and praise God. And so God doesn't really even need human beings. And so we as human beings should give God praise. But if we forsake that, God can use other things, even things in nature. And this kind of reminded me, the funny thing in our church is we have women sitting on one side and men sitting on the other side. So it's very easy to hear which side is louder. It's really easy to see and tell which side is praising God more, singing more loudly. And I'm not going to say which one it is, but if you pay attention, you may notice this. Moving on from entitlements, I want to talk a little bit about prioritization, and more in terms of prioritization when it comes to raising children. So I think we would all agree the most important thing when raising children is to prioritize holiness, righteousness, and good character. So basically prioritize a relationship with God. And it's important for us as Christians to do this when we're raising our children. So this is kind of how, and number one is set. We all should be doing it. The next ones maybe can have a little bit of flexibility, but I'm going to give you the way I'm going to prioritize the raising of my child. Next, we have intelligence, knowledge, and wisdom. So basically, academics. Now, if a person, like let's say my daughter went to school and she had a bad grade and she came back home. If my response is to badmouth her teacher, then even though I may pretend to be prioritizing holiness and good character, by my actions, I'm telling her that I prioritize number two, academics, over good character. So the actions we do as parents show what we truly prioritize. And what children end up learning is what we're showing them by the way we act. We can tell them whatever we'd like to tell them, but what they actually learn and mimic is what we do. So when it comes to prioritization, it's important for us in our lives to show what is truly important. Next, I have athletics and arts up there. So like music would fall under that category and things like that. So if I'm teaching my child when they're playing sports to not have sportsmanship and to knock people over in order to reach their goal, then I'm teaching them that I prioritize athletics over good character. So again, the way we live our lives shows what we truly prioritize. And finally, the last one I have up there is beauty. I don't really find that to be that important compared to these other ones, but to different people, it's different things. But one thing I've noticed when it comes to beauty, sometimes people are really strict with their rules when it comes to beauty. So like, people are strict about the color of your belt versus the color of your shoes. You wear brown belts with brown shoes and black belts with black shoes, and they're really strict about that. But then when it comes to sin and spiritual things, they're a little bit more wishy-washy. They're not as strict about sins and spiritual things. So if you're like that, then you're demonstrating to your child that you find beauty and things like that more important. If you tell your child, "We're not leaving the house until you fix your eyebrows," then you're showing them that you care more about beauty than other things. But Matthew chapter 6:33 says, "But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you." So the scriptures are clear on what should be number one. And to be honest, When we look at the world, the way the world treats women is that they prioritize beauty over the other things. And we can't let that happen in our families and in our churches. Because the world gives worth to women based off of their beauty. You can tell by the way they act. They may not say that, but the way they act, they objectify women. And we have to be clear when we're raising our children, and both men and both boys and girls, that we prioritize holiness first, and everything else isn't as important as that. So moving on, I want to talk a little bit about one other example. So I've been seeing a lot of things on Facebook where people are speaking against Fair and Lovely. So people are saying that, giving examples about how people are mean to them and saying that they're not going to get married if they're dark, or you're going to scare my grandkids if you're dark. And that's wrong. I agree with them. It's wrong to focus on the outside and try to lighten ourselves. And it seems obvious to people who grow in America that this is wrong because we're talking about racism and things like that. But then when we look at another culture, we're able to see that. But the truth is, there's a lot of things in a lot of cultures that emphasize the external, when the important thing is what's in our heart. And the truth is, God has created us in the way that we should be. And God has made us special and unique in the way that we should be. And we shouldn't emphasize these things like being light, because God emphasizes what's in the heart. And the interesting thing is, if we look at our pale-skinned brethren in America, they're trying to make themselves dark. So you have dark people trying to make themselves light people trying to make themselves dark. And I think what it all comes down to is kind of the regression to the mean. People don't like to be unique, they want to be average. But that's not really what God taught. As Christians, we are unique in the way that we are. And we don't need to worry about trying to conform to the social norms of this world. The world has certain expectations, and we don't have to be slaves to the expectations of this world. We can get our worth in Jesus Christ. The truth is that God knows best. And if we look at a lot of things in our lives, when it comes to appearance and things like that, God has a better plan than what the world expects. One example of this is just dyeing one's hair. So the way God has naturally made us is that when we get older, our hair gets grayer and then it becomes white. And that's a good thing. That's a thing of honor. And when we see that, we should respect people who have gray hair and white hair, because God has put a label on them that they are someone who has lived for a long time and has experienced things and have wisdom. But instead of that, we as humans sometimes try to dye our hair because the world tells us that being younger is better. But the truth of God is better. And God tells us that to be old and wise is something to be of honor. And so, if people did this more often and allowed sort of the natural thing that God designed to happen, things would be a lot easier. We wouldn't get confused about who's young and old, and it would be easier to honor people because they'd be identified by the way that they look. But the truth is, I think that God truly knows best. And a lot of times the way we naturally look is better. We don't need to try to lighten ourselves. We don't need to try to manipulate the way we look. The world has those expectations, but we have freedom in Jesus Christ to focus on something eternal instead of something that's temporal. 2 Peter 3:4 through 5 says, "Your beauty should not come from outward adornment, such as braided hair and the wearing of gold jewelry and fine clothes. Instead, it should be that of your inner self, the unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is of great worth in God's sight. So the key takeaways from today is, first, we shouldn't feel entitled as Christians. Whenever it comes to being successful, it takes effort and it takes hard work. And entitlement causes laziness. And when we were going through the book of Hebrews, it said we should make every effort to follow after God. So make sure in your lives that you haven't become entitled where you feel like you can do whatever and you'll be okay. Next, prioritization is a key thing that we should have, not just in words, but when we are raising our children. The way we act shows what we truly prioritize. And so may our actions demonstrate that we prioritize Jesus Christ and holiness and righteousness and good character over everything else. And finally, we are free as Christians. The world tries to place its expectations on us. The world tries to reduce us to our external appearance. It tries to reduce us to objects. But Jesus Christ gives us eternal worth by changing us internally so that we can demonstrate the fruit of Christ because of who we are on the inside, not who we are on the outside. Thank you.